Hi guys, and welcome to Tech of the Week. My name's Alex, I am the Deputy Mobile Editor here at Trust Reviews, and I am joined this week by Ryan, our computing writer. Now we're going to talk about a few things that we've got in the office that we've been playing with, but before that I just want to talk about something that's caught my eye this week on the news webs, and that is game streaming, namely what Google's been up to.
Okay.
Game streaming, or is going to be up to, if you will. They are talking about launching a game streaming service, and I think it's really interesting that of all the players in the space, Google's doing this.
Yes. You kind of expect it to be one of like the juggernaut gaming companies.
Absolutely.
I guess you heard about Xbox kind of getting involved, but
yeah. So we've already got like PlayStation, haven't we? We've got PlayStation and PlayStation Now. We've had companies in the past do it as well who've kind of come and gone. Like, I don't know why game streaming has become such a popular thing. I guess the infrastructure's there.
Yep. I guess people like boycotting the whole Netflix success, right? Like, get subscription, you got like an inflow of money, and people stick around, right? If the service is good, so.
Mm. Have you ever tried any of them?
The new services? No, I haven't actually, but I think there's Google one as well. It's like, I'm like not too bothered about Xbox Game Pass because I've got such a backlog of games already, but the Google stream thing is a lot more exciting, I think, because you don't actually need the hardware, right?
Yeah.
For what I'm understanding, you subscribe to a service. Most of this is like under lock and key, right? We don't know for sure any of this, but so they will stream. So you subscribe to a service, and then you can stream games to your computer, even if it's not got like a really powerful graphics card.
Which is kind of the hook with all of these services. Like, there's, I know, like OnLive kind of came and went, tried and failed, but was trying to do that back in the day on PC, and I think they also had apps on other platforms. Shadowbox is kind of like a halfway house between like. Do you know about Shadowbox?
No, I don't know.
I think it's a French company. And the Shadowbox is basically their little machine. So you plug in, you do buy a physical computer from them, and it is basically just like a portal to their servers in, I think, France or wherever.
Okay.
And they are plugging you into a much more powerful computer that you can install games on, run games. It's basically your machine. It just isn't in your house.
Yes.
But that's kind of like a peer-to-peer thing. I think this is more like, as you say, like a Netflix service where you have a selection of content.
Mm-hmm.
And you can choose to play it. What I'm not sure about is what is that content going to be? Like, Google's not going to start developing games, are they?
No. Or I think they'll be doing deals. Like, when they did their demo and showed off Assassin's Creed Odyssey.
Oh, that's right. Yes, I do remember reading about that.
So that shows, like, Ubisoft, a huge company, a third-party company. They've got the likes of Far Cry and Ghost Recon. So I don't know if they're doing a partnership with them. But it's just interesting that the first one they did show off was Assassin's Creed Odyssey.
So it's not like you're streaming from a PlayStation or an Xbox, depending on what you want to play. It's like they've just got games that are running on their platforms or on their PCs.
Potentially.
Yeah, interesting. Yeah, I'm just curious to see what that like manifests as. Mm-hmm. They're supposedly talking about it in a formal capacity on March 19th, so only a few days from now
as
we're shooting.
So we'll be watching that with popcorn, all right?
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah. I think the other thing as well, interesting on the whole thing of Google being the player, because I know like Amazon's also looking at doing this. I've read about Amazon doing a game streaming service. They've already got Lumberyard, which is like a game development platform that they've made, which is, I think, freeware, which is quite cool. Is that Google, especially in the US, they have Project Fi. They already are an internet provider as well as being all the other things that
Google
are. There's no one else in the space that I can think of who has the full end-to-end control of like the broadband or the internet and the streaming.
Nope, Google's got more covered, right?
Yeah, imagine if like Virgin in the UK started offering games to stream. Like, I think that would maybe make a really powerful combination.
Mm-hmm. Like, games are like one of the most highly profitable thing in media right now. Right?
For sure.
Like, we saw Red Dead Redemption 2 sold massive amounts of copies.
Crazy.
I can't remember the exact figure, but it was a lot, right?
Right.
So,
did it break records?
I'm pretty sure it did break some records. I don't think it sold as much as GTA 5,
right.
But it was up there, right? Mm. And if, obviously, Google's never been able to jump on board with the whole creating the hardware, come to PlayStation Xbox, but by skipping the whole hardware altogether and just, well, having it installed and offering a streaming service, then they could just bypass that all completely and offer a really good service. Or not cheaper, but you don't have to pay the whole installment right French, right? Because you're paying like a monthly fee.
Do they have the pedigree? Like, obviously, they know internet, but they don't know games. Like they showed off a gaming controller. Like there's like a patent that's leaked showing a gaming like gamepad, which kind of looks kind of like an Xbox controller, Xbox One controller.
Yes, it did as well.
But I don't know if it looks quite as nice.
Yeah, and it takes like we've seen in PlayStation, Xbox. It takes time to make a good controller. Like if you go back to the old days, like remember Nintendo 64 controller? I mean, wasn't the most comfortable.
I saw a comic the other day, which was like aliens who'd found. They were like, we've confirmed the creatures on this planet. They must have three arms. Why? And then it cuts to a picture of the 64 controller.
That makes sense, right?
Yeah, it's pretty good.
So yeah, so I think there's Xbox revealed their kind of version of this kind of streaming.
Right. Well, that's the name they're working with
right
now.
Right. Yeah.
That might not be the final product name.
So whether that's exactly similar, that might do it, like, because obviously Xbox know about how to make games.
This is what I'm saying. So I feel like they might have the potential to do better out of a game streaming platform, because people know and trust Xbox way more than Google as a game. It's weird that I think Google's getting into the space, but because it's Google, of all the companies in the world, I am very curious, because they could make it work.
Definitely. Be exciting anyway.
Yeah, for sure. But cool. It was a good little chat. Definitely check out more about that on the site if you're curious. Now, what do we have here this week? Because you've reviewed Gram branded devices in the past, but this one's a little bit different, right?
This is a bit different. So this is called the LG Gram 14 2-in-1. So as you can tell by the name, it flips into a tablet.
Is this the first of the Gram line that has this?
This is the first convertible LG Gram, correct. Yeah, so Gram have so far announced two devices this year. This is one of them is the 2-in-1, and the other one, what we haven't got our hands on yet for review, but that is the 17-inch LG Gram. Cool. And that's not convertible, that's just a big but light laptop.
Does it still adhere to like the approximately 1,000 grams?
So it's a little bit high. I think it's about...
like 1,500 or something?
About 13.
Okay, so it's still under a gram and a half. Okay.
So it's still really one of the most portable devices, 17-inch devices anyway. But anyway, so yeah, the Gram lineup is all about lightweight, right? Uh-huh. So a convertible laptop is nothing new.
Yeah.
We've seen loads. The Dell XPS had one last year.
Sure.
But the difference is, like, as Gram, it's really light. Like, you have a feel of that.
Oh, yeah, that's pretty good, actually.
So when you've got a convertible mode, it actually does feel like a tablet. I've been put off of convertible laptops before because... it's just heavy, Like, you don't want this massive thing as a tablet. Yeah, yeah. I mean, if it's holding up at night, I mean, get a flat face because you dropped it on you during a midnight marathon. But this is light enough.
It feels pretty sturdy too.
Yeah.
Like, I know it's plastic. Is this plastic bodied?
I think it's kind of like...
Or is it a mix?
Like an aluminium of it? I'm not sure. I'll have to double check that.
It feels pretty well built and sturdy.
It feels really sturdy.
And not too heavy considering it's robust.
But like, the LG Gram devices have always been like pretty robust. I'm a bit concerned about when you turn the tablet mode, it feels a bit of a flex here because it's not perfectly.
Oh, because it's got like a rounded base.
That's right.
When it's in laptop mode, so that it suddenly gives you this huge lip.
Yeah,
that's
a bit concerning. And I've got a few issues with. The device seems a bit confused when you kind of swap it into, because obviously there's like a tablet mode that kicks in.
I mean, Windows Touch experience, I've never thought has been particularly strong. No. But I know that some people like it, or it has its values and for some people.
Yeah, so it's all right, but like I said, it's a bit sluggish converting between the two.
Yeah.
And it can take a bit of a while to like understand what's going on, so that's a bit of an issue. But at the same time, it's still getting a really good, versatile experience here. A tablet and a laptop, right? And it's so lightweight, and it's got a really good processor, so it's got an 8th gen i7 processor.
Oh shoot, okay, so it's not even like it's a small little light. Basic machine, it's a powerhouse.
This is a proper powerhouse ultrabook, right? So this is like competing with the likes of like MacBook Air, the Surface Book. To be honest, when I reviewed the LG Gram 14, the standard edition, that was, I gave it a 9 out of 10 for rating, and
it was
recommended.
Same generation, 8th gen chips?
Yes, it's the same processor. This actually has the same processor, but it's slightly more optimized, so you actually do get better benchmark scores, which is quite surprising to me.
Nice.
It's got the same integrated GPU as well, but this has actually got lower than the standard LG Gram benchmark scores.
Does that have much of an effect in terms of actual real-world use? Like, if both of them are integrated graphics, presumably you're not going to do much more than watch high-res streaming content or something.
So you might be able to do like the most basic of Photoshop devices, if you're like wanting a machine to do proper media savvy tasks, then this isn't the device for you. This is a portable ultrabook, like I said, ultra portable. You can do office, straight standard office work, watch Netflix, do standard browsing, and it goes really fast.
So like a good student's laptop or a good expensive student's laptop, I imagine, or good business laptop for general business stuff.
Yeah, it's not cheap, it's about, I think the price is around £1,300.
Okay. How does that compare to the other grams, like the 14 that you reviewed?
So I think it's around the same price, actually. Okay. I think the normal gram might be a little bit cheaper. But like I said, this does have a few sacrifices compared to the standard gram. Like I mentioned before, the GPU power maybe isn't as powerful, even though it's got the same integrated power. Mm-hmm. I've also noticed, I don't know if you can see, just open this up now. Use the fingerprint,
fingerprint feature. On the keyboard. It's kind of in the same place as the MacBook Pro, right?
Yeah, so on the power button, right?
Nice,
so
touch.
If you see there. And also, I don't know if you noticed, but there's a bit of like a warm tint to the display.
Okay.
So the standard gram was a lot more kind of neutral light. It looks a bit whiter and cleaner.
Could they fix that with either software, or can you calibrate it yourself? Or is it
you could calibrate it, but I think it's more inherently to do the panel, yeah. So
and
I think
what we got is a full HD panel?
Full HD, yes. Okay. And it's obviously touchscreen. So yeah. I think that's why we had to make sacrifice. It's not just a normal panel anymore, it's touchscreen. So. But at the same time, it's a small sacrifice, and to get the versatility of a convertible is, for me, worth it. So if you're looking for a touchscreen convertible, then I honestly think this could be one of the best ones in store.
Is this one of the best Gram entrants as well? In the Gram line, would you say this is the best option? If you are a fan of the Gram?
It depends what you want, right?
Like, well, the Instagram.
So I think they're both very good, but it just depends, do you want the touchscreen or not?
Right, and so the regular one doesn't have a touchscreen?
No.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so it's just, you can just have like straightforward, a slightly cheaper performance power, or just have a touchscreen and like sacrifice a bit of display. So it's just down to the user. I think both are very good.
They're just slightly different use cases.
Yeah, and it depends what you want.
Cool, no, nice, very cool. So LG Gram, is that reviewed? Have we covered it already, or are you testing it right now? What's happening?
So I'm in the process of testing it.
Yeah.
I don't think the review will be up by the time this video comes up, but expect it to be in the following week.
Yeah, so wait for that one.
Yeah.
It'll be worth the wait, though.
Definitely.
I'm excited. No, that seems really cool. Nice. Cool. I'm going to tell you about the thing I brought with me.
Ooh, exciting.
It's a little bit more colourful. Does that come in any other colours, I should ask?
No, I don't think it does. Oh, it's just this, like, nice greyish colour, I think you call it, but...
So, Samsung, they've gone crazy, and
oh my God, that's bright.
With this little number here. So this is the canary yellow. Samsung Galaxy S10E. Now, we've already covered all of the S10 phones in a hands-on. They've actually launched four S10 devices just before we went off to Mobile World Congress. One of which is a 5G phone, which isn't actually out yet, but they showed it off at MWC. We saw it. We've got hands-ons with all of them. We actually already have a full review of the standard S10 Plus, which is the one that they were pushing, and it's the one that you'll see in all the posters right now. The S10e, though, I think might be the most interesting member of the bunch, despite being technically the most basic. The E in the S10e apparently stands for essential. So it's everything that the S10 line should offer, minus some of the fancier accoutrements.
Okay, that makes sense. So I'm guessing that comes with a cheaper price, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So this is the cheapest of the bunch. But I would say the price performance, it's a pretty good. Like, I don't think they sacrifice too much. The essential stuff, like what they have trimmed out, there's a couple of things I am sad about, but overall I think you're getting a pretty complete S10 experience from this phone. So A, it's smaller.
Yep.
It's 5.8 inch 19:9 display rather than I think it's a 6.1 or a 6.4 if you go for the S10. The S10 Plus.
It's not a huge difference, I
suppose. No, and like footprint in the hand, because the screen does go basically to the edge of the front, it's pretty small overall form factors. It's quite nice to use.
Okay.
The other thing is, we maybe have separate shots of this or something, or if you look at the photos on the site, you'll see that the front of the phone, unlike the other phones, it's not rounded. So the curved glass that Samsung, the curved display that Samsung does on its other phones, like you have an S9.
Yes, that's right.
So you know the edges curve off.
Yeah, yeah.
This is flat. This is a flat phone. So it's much more like the iPhone XR, which has the bigger bezel.
Yep. It does look quite a lot like the XR, actually, doesn't it?
It definitely has some similarities to the XR, but again, the bezels are slimmer. And the other important thing to notice is the front camera is in the screen. So it's
like a punch hole. Is that how we call it? A punch hole?
Yeah, hole punch. I mean, there's punch. So many different terms, but yeah, hole punch.
Got an argument about that.
Yeah. I think I put a Twitter poll out just to see what the masses wanted, and I think they ended up choosing the stupidest, longest answer.
Typical Twitter.
Yeah, exactly. But the camera's good. It's a 10 meg unit, but it's set within the display. It's called an Infinity O display because it's like an O. Just a single camera on here, same as the regular S10. The bigger one has dual cameras on the front, and that can do depth effects like you get on other phones.
Right, I can zoom in, make it better.
It's not lossless zoom. I think you can zoom in. I don't know about the front cameras actually. Typically, phones don't let you zoom in on the front cameras. I know iPhones don't. But the back cameras is a little bit more interesting because, you know, we've had phones now with two cameras for a while. The S9 Plus, for example, the bigger brother to your phone, had two cameras and it did have lossless zoom. That was the second camera.
Okay.
The telephoto.
Yes.
What they've done here is they've not given you lossless zoom. You don't have any, like, it's regular zoom, lossy zoom, if you will. Instead, the secondary camera is a wide-angle camera, ultra-wide.
Ah, I see.
And I think I'm still playing with the camera. I think that's the better option. I don't know what you prefer, like, when you're shooting. Like, do you find yourself zooming in much when you're taking photos?
Depends on, I think quite a lot, sometimes subjects like
okay,
a far
so maybe
away,
this isn't the right choice. Maybe for you, the S10 is a better choice, because that has three cameras, as does the S10 Plus on the back. So that has the main 12 meg sensor, has the same wide angle as well, but then it also has a telephoto.
I see,
So Samsung's crop that telephoto out of this one, but you still get the wide angle, and I think that is makes for really good creative shooting. The size, the camera, all of that stuff feels really well considered. Another thing that you do lose from the main S10 phones is they are the first phones with a ultrasonic in-display fingerprint sensor. So
what a name of
it's catchy, right? Yeah. So like LG have put the fingerprint sensor into the power button.
Yes.
Samsung have put it into the display, and it's a more advanced tech than what we saw from the likes of the OnePlus 6T,
okay.
Which was an optical.
Does that make it a lot more convenient?
Convenient, yes, and it means it makes for a cleaner design, but it's definitely not as fast. This thing,
okay. Honestly,
the fingerprint sensor is on the side of the phone. And not only is it like, it's like old school fingerprint sensors that phones had.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't, like, it's really good. I kind of almost prefer it. The placement's really nice if you're right-handed. Because obviously, okay. If you're left-handed, you've got the index finger, it's not quite as easy. Yeah.
Sorry, left-handers.
Yeah, sorry, lefties. And also, yeah, so it's really, really snappy, and you can have gestures. You can swipe down.
That's really nice, actually. Yeah.
And get the notifications playing, which I really like.
Why did they not pull them aside to begin with? It makes much more sense.
I don't know, it's pretty crazy, because, yeah, look, my hand naturally rests right there, and you just boom.
Genius.
Yeah, it's good. So, in a way, I kind of prefer this to the fancier in-display option mm-hmm. that they've done on the other phones.
Plus, you're probably getting smudged all over, like, repeatedly putting your phone
exactly
on it.
You're automatically smudging a phone yeah. Every time you open it. So, yeah. So, there's a whole host of things. You still get HDR screen. You still get wireless charging and reverse wireless charging, or wireless power share, as they call it. Still IP68 water resistant. It's, like, loaded. It has 6 gigs of RAM, whereas the S10 can come with 8 gigs.
Mm-hmm.
128 gigabytes of storage, expandable memory. Like, it's
got a lot,
you know,
or nearly.
If they didn't launch the other two phones, this would still be considered a flagship, yep. I think. It's good enough. And it's £130 cheaper than the base S10 at $669.
For smartphones these days,
yeah,
it's quite cheap.
Exactly, yeah, I know, it still sounds like a hell of a lot of money. But yeah, overall, like, you know, that's not a million miles away from the OnePlus 6T,
mm-hmm.
which was, let's say,
the
go-to affordable flagship, like, benchmark.
Yes.
And with all that in mind, yeah, I think this has a real potential to sell really well. I don't know what the contract pricing is like, but I think it's going to be good.
Okay.
So
for you personally, you're going to buy a new Galaxy phone, which one would it be?
Yeah.
Using your money, obviously.
The problem is I really do like having that telephoto. Like, I love having the versatility. So I probably would go for the S10.
Okay. The yellow, not flamingo, sorry, the yellow canary colour won't persuade you.
Yeah, yeah. Also, that is something of note. If you do like a colourful phone, and I do appreciate when manufacturers do a colourful phone.
Yes, definitely.
Because there's not enough of them doing
so
it.
So many greys, blacks and whites.
Exactly. LG, come and sort it out. Give me a yellow laptop.
Give
That'd
me a flamingo pink.
Yes.
LG Gram.
Yeah, so we mentioned this before. So in America, you can also get flamingo pink,
yes.
which we don't get here in the UK, which is a bit of a bummer. But you do get prism white, blue and green, I think it is. And they all look very nice.
They're all called prism white.
Prism, yeah, yeah. They're all like...
So we run out of ideas for cutting.
I don't know why they should have stuck with the birds. Like cockatoo green would have been cool.
See, I would buy that just because of me.
Yeah, exactly. Take notes, Samsung marketing team. But yeah, I think it's really good. I think it maybe will be the one, kind of like Apple was hoping with the iPhone XR, it might be the one that sells the best.
Okay.
Despite not having all of the features, because for the price, you're still getting the same processor
yes.
and so many other parts of that S10 experience. Mm-hmm. And the size is really, really good. There aren't many small phones nowadays.
No.
It's a really good one. So yeah, that is, in a nutshell, the S10E. I'm still working on the review right now, but it'll be up on the site. I'm hoping this week, if not, start next week.
Great.
So by the time you watch this, it might be up on the site. But yeah, really nice.
Cool.
So stay tuned for that. I think that's everything.
Because that's everything. Right. Nothing to say.
Yeah, well, no, I can chat about this for ages, but I won't bore you. You read the review, that's the best way to do it. But yeah, so guys, thank you so much for tuning in. If you enjoyed this, please let us know in the comment section down below. And if you want, you can always like and subscribe the video too. That's always really, really appreciated.
Mm-hmm.
Stay tuned to Trotter Reviews. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you next week.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
Computing writer.
Do you want that, or do you want to have a fun other time? No. What about the Archduke of Computing or something?
That sounds good.
I talked about one of the phones in the past and then put it under my leg, and someone got really upset that I just did that, and they were like, why has he done that? Is it a wall, or is it more of like a screen?
It's plastic wall, like a perfume.
Terrifying.
Punch it.
Chewy.
Don't punch it.
Don't punch it, Chewy. You ready?
Yep.